Welcome and good morning to this DDEX webinar, which is about a brand new standard which was literally published yesterday, known as PIE, which stands for Party Identification and Enrichment. My name is Mark Isherwood, and I'm part of the DDEX Secretariat, and I'll provide you with a brief overview of DDEX and talk generally about party identification and its importance. And then my colleague Niels Rump will talk about PIE itself and how it relates to other standards within DDEX, particularly the MEAD and ERN standards, and then also give you some details about how PIE is constructed. So, as you know, DDEX is a standards organization, and our remit is to create more efficient communication along the value chain, primarily of the digital music industry. And obviously, that has a lot to do with the management of metadata. We do this in three ways. Probably what we're best known for is the development of standard formats, which set out the order in which data elements relating to a particular transaction must be put into a computer message and what the relationships are between them so that the recipient of the message can see what data and elements are being communicated to them. We also set standards in terms of choreographies. What we mean by choreographies is the order in which messages get exchanged, and things like trigger points, which determine when a message should actually be sent or when you should expect to receive one. And that will vary depending on the type of business transaction that a set of messages are actually trying are being used for. And then finally, we define protocols by which the messages are actually exchanged. For most of the last 15 years of DDEX's existence, that has meant secure FTP sites. And obviously, we can only do fairly straightforward things like file naming conventions and directory order and that kind of thing. But increasingly, we are moving towards web services, which creates a great deal more automation and gives the recipients and the senders of messages much greater insight into what is going on in terms of what the other party is doing with the information that's been sent to them in a message. So as I've mentioned already, DDEX has been around for 15 years. We do consider it now to be ubiquitous, certainly in terms of ERN. And to a slightly lesser extent, DSR. The other messages, which are slightly more particular and for particular groups of companies that perform certain types of roles, they are also well established. But we're also always working to increase the level of implementation A way of showing that is that at the moment we've issued well in excess of 6,500 implementation licenses. And although we actually have limited actual data about implementations, we do obviously know that there is a huge amount of implementation and a lot of work goes into using DDEX standards to exchange metadata. So there isn't really a company that is serious about being part of the modern music industry that is not using DDEX. So this is our increasingly complex, or at least it appears complex, tube map, which shows the different standards that we have. I think we're now into 9 or 10 families of standards here. And obviously, each of them gets used in different parts of the industry, depending on the nature of the business transaction that's taking place. And what we're focusing on at the moment and for this webinar is the party identification and enrichment, which is the sort of magenta open line. In other words, it's not filled color. At the moment, that shows itself to be primarily being used amongst record companies, distributors, DSPs, and metadata companies. And certainly, that is the area where the requirement was initially identified. But we see over time, once people start to use the PI standard, that it can be used in conjunction with any of the DDEX messaging standards, not just MEAD and ERN. So obviously the focus today is around that group of types of companies and the exchange of metadata that they undertake around MEAD and ERN, but now with this brand new standard with PI as well. Lastly, around DDEX's standards, just to emphasize the importance of our data dictionary, it is very much the lingua franca of the music industry now. If you don't speak DDEX, it's going to be tricky for you to communicate with your business partners. And the data dictionary is really the beating heart of DDEX, because it contains all of the terms in all of the messages, their semantics, and also the structure of what we call composites. And when we say common competence, it means things that, you know, are common to the industry, like parties. There are certain data elements that make up the description of a party, and we call that a composite, and the same applies to other common entities within the music industry, like musical works, sound recordings, and so on and so on. And you can see all of those elements in the data dictionary. So let me turn now a little bit more to party identification. And of course, a very well-known example that is often used in talking about parties is John Williams. I think there are about 14 John Williams in the music industry globally, but these are probably the two that are best known. John Williams, the guitarist, and John Williams, the composer of music for films such as Star Wars. And the reason it's important to be able to distinguish between the two doesn't just apply to today's marketplace, but what we're saying here really does focus on streaming services that want to be able to have home pages for different artists or composers or whatever type of producers, for example. So it's very important, if they want to have those home pages, that they can very clearly distinguish between the two John Williamses, and that the repertoire that is on the page is actually the repertoire performed or composed by the right John Williams, and that we don't see guitar performances under John Williams, the composer, and we don't see Star Wars under John Williams, the guitarist. So what are the ways of making that distinction? One of the ways is to use AI, or to have a lot of people working within the DSP to investigate the metadata they've been given to try and make the distinction between the two Johns. As may well have happened in the past, the label, when sending information about the John Williams that they have an interest in, can put that information into the party composite. But even then, just describing a John Williams may not necessarily be enough to make a distinction between the two. And so the best solution is to use unique identification. And we can see that these three solutions are actually, you know, in order of improvement and more likelihood of being able to actually make the distinction in such a way that computers can understand and make the distinction that is needed, rather than having to involve human beings. And there are a number of party identification systems, all of which are catered for within the DDEX messages. First of all, this is not in order of creation, but one of the better known ones, which is an open standard, is the international standard name identifier, which identifies what's called public personas. Then there's the IPN, which is a party identification system for performers, which is owned and operated by the SCARPRA society. So those are the societies that collect royalties for performers on sound recordings, whether they're featured artists or just contributors of other kind. There is also the IPI name number, which is again a private system which is owned and operated by CSAC, and that identifies writers, composers, authors, and publishers. Within that, the CSAC also has a society number for identification of each of the collecting societies. And of course, individual companies have their proprietary identifiers for parties in order to make distinctions within their own systems. Obviously, that becomes less valuable once you start mixing up proprietary identifiers from more than one company. The validity of those identifiers becomes less pronounced, and we really need to move towards unique identifiers of the ISNI type, which is public, is an open identification service and a way of uniquely distinguishing between our two Johns, or indeed our 14 Johns, if that ever becomes necessary. The last one on there is also an identification system, the DDEX party identification system, but all that does is to identify the endpoints of a communication of a message using a DDEX standard. It does no more than that and was never intended to. So I'm now going to hand over to Niels, and he will talk more now about PI, MEAD, ERN, and the detail behind PI. So Niels, over to you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mark. Good morning, everybody. Good afternoon. So let's talk about MEAD and ERN. We started to discuss about the subjects of rich metadata, which the first two of those standards provide, about 5 years ago, I would think. And we started to realize that the music delivery, or rather the way consumers interact with music, is changing significantly. Over the last, since the start of the digital music revolution in the late 1990s, you could say that the bigger the screen, the better the user experience. The original iPod on the left-hand side of the screen there had a very, very innovative, very nice user interface, but compared with Spotify or Deezer or any of those services that you actually have on a big screen, it pales in comparison. But since the last few years, we actually find devices without any screen size at all, and yet we want to make sure that we have actually good user experience for those. And it works. When you now have these speakers without any screens, without any display, you still need to provide a rich user experience, but that needs rich information to fuel the artificial intelligence that underpins those systems. What we want to be able to do is allow consumers to ask questions like the ones on the screen. Alexa, play me the song Eminem sampled in Stan. So the system needs to know what song we're talking about and what musician we're talking about. They then need to cross-reference that with other songs, with other recordings, and you will end up with thank you from Dido, hopefully. And you have other examples. So if we're just looking at one of those examples, play something from the female singer on the live version of Don't Give Up. Well, you need to have a list of all the popular tracks called Don't Give Up. You need to differentiate between live and the studio version. You need to have lineups of the tracks with the people and their gender. You need to have to identify a prominent female singer amongst those people. And then find another track of that singer. Hopefully you end up with Paula Cole, not with Kate Bush, which is the studio version. So these kind of things you need to do, and that needs rich information. Where can that data come from? Well, it can come from record companies, and they want to and do provide that information to DSPs that then can use the information. That comes from their supply chain systems, for example, the track listing, as well as the musician lineup. But ERN doesn't say anything about whether Paula Cole, for example, is female, male, or non-binary, for example. And but it does not only need to come from the supply chain systems, the core supply chain systems. It may also come from marketing systems within the record companies, or it can come from third-party metadata providers. So what are we talking about with in terms of messaging? ERN is, as Mark has said earlier, the most used standard amongst the DDEX standards at all. It provides core metadata about the products, so the works, the recordings, the releases, the parties, and the deals under which those products, those releases can be made available to consumers. But it focuses very much on the operational, on the practical, on the core information. And when it comes to PI and MEAD, they are basically twin standards, if you like. They provide rich metadata that provides context that then enables artificial intelligence to actually make proper decisions and display or render the best content on a smart speaker. PI focuses on parties, whereas MEAD focuses on the stuff, the musical works, the recordings, sound recordings and videos, the releases. The first version of MEAD actually also included party information, but we decided to actually split those into two different standards because it's to some extent slightly different stuff or information that needs to be communicated about the music and about the people that make the music. So how is the stuff being communicated? It's fairly simple. There are three parties involved. You have the record company from which a lot of the information, especially the ERN information, comes. So you have the ERN feed from a record company to a DSP, which contains the new release message, the resource files, but then can also include PI and MEAD messages. But you can also have third-party metadata provider, which might be a company like Nielsen or Jackstar, or it might be something like Music Brains, some kind of a provider of metadata. They collect metadata and want to share it with the community. Whether there's money involved or not, doesn't really matter. The standard allows them to provide that information. So you can have a separate PI feed or MEAD feed that just communicates that information to consumers. But it's also, as I said earlier, you can have a separate PI or MEAD feed from record companies, not so much out of their supply chain systems, but other systems, marketing systems, to provide richer information. And they may want to provide a party and musicians service, which provides then rich information that a record company, that the marketing department, for example, of a record company has collated for DSPs to tap into and make sure that the information is available to consumers. And we've developed a number of choreographies. I'll go fairly quickly over these because it's not really that interesting. If it's sent as a part of an ERN feed, it is just another resource file, basically. It's treated like an MP3 file. It's slightly linked differently. But if you want to send an ERN message, you first put up all the MP3 files or AAC or whatever the encoder may be, Atmos, doesn't matter. You put them up. You then add the MEAD and PI messages for the individual parties or resources releases that are referenced in the ERN message. And then you put the XML for the ERN message itself, which then points to the MP3 files and which points to the MEAD and PI messages. And then the DSP has the information and the AI system that the DSP employs can go to town with that information. The other things that we have are either a symmetric or an asymmetric web service, so where either the DSP and the or this metadata sender and the metadata recipient either both offer web services and they can call each other, or only one of those parties, the metadata provider, has a web service which is then being pinged by the person who wants to have that information. That all exists as well as a separate FTP communication. Fairly straightforward. We have basically copied for PI what MEAD has already done, and MEAD is basically a slightly more involved copy-paste job from the ERN choreography for web services or for FTP. So they all work in very much the same way. But what's actually in a PI message? Well, that's how it looks on the top level. Let's go through those four main elements turn by turn. First, we have a couple of attributes. You can provide, as usual, the language in which all the metadata is to be provided, which you can then override in individual tags. I can show that to you in a little bit. We also now, all the DDEX standards starting actually this year, will have an allowed value set version ID. So the allowed value sets, which are basically the code lists that we're using for DDEX messages, they are provided in a separate XML schema definition file, and this defines the version thereof. You would typically always use the latest version, but by indicating this version number, you can tell the recipient that you're actually using an older version in your internal processing, then is actually provided as part of the standard. The current version that we have is version 2. We then have the usual message header, which is really for housekeeping: who sent a message to whom, what's the identity of that message, every message has a unique identifier, and when was it being created. Oh, and last but not least, quite important, is it a test message or is it a message sent in anger, so to speak? That's quite important actually for implementing the stuff and making sure that if you're starting to use the standard, you can actually first test it before you start using it as part of your normal operations. We then have something which we introduced first in the MEAD standard, which is what we call the metadata source. PI and MEAD provide information from or allow information to be provided from various sources to a DSP, not just from the quote owner unquote of the content. ERN is sent from the owner of the content to the DSP. They should have all the information authoritatively and can send that to the DSP. But MEAD and PI, it's slightly different. If you're receiving information from, let's say, music brains, well, it's actually not the information that is authoritatively from the owner or the person that you're talking about. It's somebody else said that. Or if you're providing a service about biographies, biography is one of the tags within the party list. Well, somebody wrote that biography. And it's quite important for the DSP to know who actually wrote that biography or who claimed that a party is of a specific gender or that a party is somewhat related to the other party. So to have the ability to say who says about a metadata item, that is not core identity, but that's this richer information, is essential. And that's what the metadata source provides. It allows the sender of the message to say, here's a piece of information, and that information, I assert that is the case, or I have heard it from her, and she asserts that information. And last but not least, and that's the main thing, that's the party list. And I would suggest that we actually look at the XSD directly. If I can make it, there it is. I hope you can all see this. Yes, it looks like it. So this is the XML schema definition for the MEAD message. And as you can see, there are three main tags in the message. The feed, that's for the web service, the asymmetric web service, in which a metadata provider can provide an atom feed to its customers, to its business partners, who can then read that feed and see what new information is available. A DSP or anybody who wants to receive rich party information can also request information about parties, message header, and then you have information about the party that is being requested, either by name or by party identifier. And then you can say, well, I want to know something about John William, the composer, rather than the guitarist, or John Williams, the chap who was in the opening of who wrote Schindler's List, for example. That kind of information you can request, and in response, you would then get a PI message. And this we just looked at. And here is the rather long list of tags that the PI message can talk about. For one, as I said, you can always, and that applies not just on this level, but further down as well, you can always override the language and script that has been provided on message level. And you can then say, all right, the message is all in English, but this party is all in French. If that's what you want to do, that's how you do this. And I'll go through this in a slightly odd way, because some of the tags will become clearer later on. Party, so I'll ignore party reference for now. Party ID, well, that's all the different party IDs that Mark introduced earlier on his slide, isn't it? Well, they're all supported here within DDEX. You can provide an ISNI, a DPID, a DDEX party ID, an IPI name number, an IPN, a CSX society ID, or as many proprietary identifiers as you want. This composite is actually used not just in PI, but throughout all most DDEX standards in either this form or slightly adapted form. If we're talking about, for example, composers only in another message, well, it does make sense to have an IPN there because composers are not identified by IPNs, but by IPIs. But this is the most generic party ID composites that we have. You then have the ability to communicate the name. And this is now the most comprehensive name composite that we actually have ever created. You can identify, uniquely identify a name, because sometimes a different name for a party is being uniquely identified as its own identifier. So that happens sometimes with ISNI or IPI specifically. So looking at IPI, for example, if you have John Williams and J. Williams, the IPI standard will differentiate them and give different identifiers to this. But there's the same party, it's the same public persona. Therefore, we would typically, within the PI message, communicate John Williams and J. Williams as one party, assuming we're talking about the same person, obviously. But you may need to communicate two names with two IPI name numbers for it. We have information about the party name type, and that's an allowed value set, whether it's a legal name, nickname, a pseudonym, a stage name. So we can separate stage names from legal names and those kind of pieces of information. If someone marries, they change their name. If someone changes their sex, they or gender, they sometimes change their name. Well, there we have the ability to communicate such a reason. What's the purpose for having this name? Is it for correspondence? Is it for contract? Is it for credits? Those pieces of information can be communicated. And then we have the actual bits that, or the format of the name, sorry. Is it misspelled? Is it for indexed? Is it a translation? Those kind of pieces of information can be provided. And then you have all the actual bits that actually describe the name. The full name, John Williams. The full name ASCII transcribed. That's quite helpful when you're dealing with the names that are in other character sets rather than ASCII. How do you index him? So Williams, comma, John. Titles before names. I don't know whether any of the John Williams has had any. Names before the key name, in John Williams's case, that would be John. The key name would be Williams. Names after the key name, sometimes you have patronyms or matronyms that come after the name. And then you have PhDs and other titles. You may have a short name or an abbreviated name. And names might differ from in different periods of time. P. Diddy is one of those examples. Puff Diddy, P. Diddy, same party, same persona, but had differently spelled names over the time. You want to say when which name was valid. But you can also provide different names for different creations. Somebody was known as that under that name on this sound recording, same party, same persona, but was known under this name, maybe now spelled in all caps or whatever the artist feels is appropriate. On a different creation. So you can provide really, really rich information about parties. And Marcus said earlier that we expect PI to be used in other standards and other communications within the DDEX ecosystem. And it's especially this rich party naming composite with the ability to say, well, this is a name that we want to use for communications or for licensing or for those kind of things. That's what Mark was mostly referring to. This composite we hope to utilize in other standards going forward, either embed that into the standard or maybe provide a sidecar, if you like, that can communicate together with that other message in a PI-ish way. So what other things are of interest here? Related party is one of those things that is quite interesting. You may want to say that John Lennon was a member of the Beatles. The Beatles is one party, John Lennon is another party. We need to create a relationship. So first of all, we need to point to the other party, either by pointing to another party composite in the same PI message, and there is this party reference which points to, at the very top, let me collapse this, at the very top you have this party reference. So you can then point from one party to another party by using this reference, but you may also just want to give it a name in a message if you're not communicating that person, that band, that organization in the same message, or by party ID. So if you're describing John Lennon, you could simply say, hey, the other party that I'm talking about are the Beatles, and just use the ISNI for the Beatles or another identifier. You can say when this was valid, and you have a party relationship type, and that is again an allowed value set. And there you have that somebody is a full member of the Beatles, which would be in this case the case. Billy Preston, for example, who played on the last Beatles album, or Eric Clapton, you could classify them as an affiliate member of the Beatles, if that's what the sender of the message wants to assert. And that's where it becomes critical. Here you have the metadata source reference. Here you can say, hey, Neil said Billy Preston was an affiliate member of the Beatles, for example. And a DSP could then say, that information came from Neil's. Nah, we're not going to take that. That's typically bad information. Let's throw that out. But somebody else said John Lennon is a proper member of a full member of the Beatles. That information we trust. That's what that information is about. You can list other creations. You can list the gender for a message. You can see all the information that's out there or included in the message. Interesting to mention is the focus track. One of the things that is quite important to record companies is to enable DSPs to react to things like play me the latest song from John Williams. Now, notwithstanding that it's unknown which John Williams we're talking about, I assume that the DSP will look into the history of the consumer there and see, that person listens a lot to film music, so most likely he's talking about John Williams, the composer, whereas somebody else who may listen a lot to classical guitar music, well, in that case, the DSP will assume John Williams, the guitarist, is being used as the person. But if you're saying, play me the latest John Williams track, that's not necessarily the latest one that has been released. That is the one that's currently marketed most aggressively, most proactively by the record company. And this is the way to communicate that to DSP. This is how the marketing system of the label can say to the DSP, oh, by the way, the focus track for John Williams is Schindler's List. Here are other things like biographies. I talked about that. Here is the text of the biography. Here is the author of the biography. And then you have the information about who then claimed that this is actually the biography for a specific party and so forth. You can provide information about awards that a consumer has received, by whom, who was it. So talking about John Lennon again, if the Beatles were received an award, unlikely these days, so the Beatles would be the awarded party. And again, you can provide them through a party ID or a party name. That's kind of the same composite we use in other places. So you would then include just the ISNI for the Beatles, for example. And what's the award that was awarded? What's the date? Whether they were a winner or just being nominated, and provide some text to go with it. So there's quite a lot of information, as you can see here. Quite a little bit of that was actually part of the MEAD message before we carved the party bit out of the MEAD message and put it in here. But what is definitely new and much, much enhanced is the handling of party names, which is really, really complex. And by the way, also supports pronunciation. So you can give a name, John Williams, and then provide pronunciation information. How should that be pronounced? Because if I have a smart speaker and I ask it to play John Williams, it needs to know how I pronounce John Williams, which may very well be different in England or in the US from, let's say, Japan. And the other way around also, the speaker needs to be able to pronounce the name, not just listen and understand me pronouncing the name. So that's basically what the message contains. If there are any questions, I'm more than happy to go back to what we've just looked at. But just to close the thing off, PI 1.0 and MEAD 1.1 were published yesterday. They are on the knowledge base. They're ready to be implemented. And we know that MEAD is already being implemented as we speak. We expect the initial implementations in 2021. Since the difference between MEAD 1.1 and the older 1.0 is comparatively minor, the only real change is that we've taken the party information out of MEAD and put it elsewhere, PI that is. I expect most implementations to actually be of MEAD 1.1 rather than 1.0. It will happen over the course of this summer. At least that's what the indications are. As Mark has said at the very beginning, we don't have reliable information of which company implements what when, but the informal discussions were around that time frame. PI implementations will, I expect, follow a bit later, but it uses the same structure. So if I've implemented MEAD, implementing PI is actually comparatively straightforward. It uses the same choreography, it uses the same mechanism to be linked to an ERN message, and the overall structure of the message is basically the same. And last but certainly not least, just to re-emphasize that the work on this party composite is something that we plan to reuse across the DDEX ecosystem, the various standards. So the identifiers, the name descriptor, the handling of transcriptions, translations is something that we will be making use of across the board. This is the first standard that uses this rich way of describing parties. We're now starting to, since that has been agreed and published, we can now use that composite and saying, hey, here is the better way of describing parties. Why don't we use it in the licensing standard or in the radar standard or indeed in the ERN standard itself? That is what we have. If there are any questions, we're more than happy to answer them or try to answer them.